Hi, everybody. I'm Kevin Bierman, the creative director here at Chicago Ideas, and I am absolutely thrilled to welcome you all to a virtual happy hour with Sam Irby. I hope everyone who can partake responsibly has their cocktail ready and are as excited as I am to hear from the OG social distancing queen herself. If there's something you want to ask our presenters tonight, you can submit your questions via Twitter using the hashtag Chicago Ideas, or you can submit your questions to the Ask a Question box below to join the conversation. And now, without further ado, I'd like to bring our happy hour host for the evening, the hilarious, the talented Fawzia Mirza. Fawzia?
Hi.
Thanks so much for joining us.
Hi. Thank you for having me. I'm here.
It's good to have you.
It's great to be here. Well, I have to say, I'm super excited to do this. Y'all emailed me and I don't even know if I asked any of the dates or conditions. I didn't ask anything. I just knew that Sam was going to be there and there was a date and a time and it was happening for sure. And I just said, yes, like that's, I consented immediately. Like I just give enthusiastic yeses to hang out with Sam. So I know some of y'all have tuned in, probably know Sam's work. But let me just tell you a little bit more in case you don't. Long before Samantha Irby was proclaimed our great bard of quarantine by the New York Times, fans have adored her unflinching, riotous, and relatable writings from her blog, Bitches Gotta Eat, to her best-selling books, Meaty, and We Are Never Meeting in Real Life. Sam is joining us tonight to discuss her latest bestseller, Wow, No Thank You, a rip-roaring, edgy, and unabashedly raunchy new collection of essays. Sam Irby.
Fawzia Mirza, as I live and breathe.
Oh, hello.
Hello.
What are you drinking?
A margarita. It's a margarita.
I have some rosé vodka cocktail made by my partner.
Whoa, my partner made this. Cheers to us for having people who make cocktails for us.
Cheers to us.
If I made a cocktail, it would be like Stoli Raspberry and 7-Up, which is what I used to drink in 2002.
Well, when I make a cocktail, it's usually vodka with bitter splashes in it, and that's it. There's no ice. There's no mixer. I'm just like, this is fine, right? This isn't like...
That sounds like really fancy. Anytime a person uses bitters, I'm like, excuse me, James Bond.
Oh, I'm sorry. Bitters is basically just like another form of Alka-Seltzer. It's just more expensive.
Still fancy. How many people have bitters in their home? You know, we probably have some, but I want to be clear that it's not me who bought them.
That's fair. Honestly, I have to tell you, your wife is one of my favorite humans, even from a distance, because her, everything she does really is, and I know you talk about this in the book, but everything she does and posts on Instagram is perfect. And I honestly, I made a focaccia garden because of your wife.
That's incredible. I don't even know where she keeps the flour, so... You are better than I am. Like all of this shit behind me, like the fruit and the flowers.
Yeah.
I didn't buy that. I didn't put that there. I mean, I maybe paid for it, but I didn't like pick it and put it in the vase.
Honestly, that's why we marry.
Yeah. That's, you have to find someone who has like your opposite life skills,
yeah,
in order to make it work. And I don't know what I bring to her life. I know, like, I can memorize like all the channels of the DirecTV, but like I'm like USA 242, but other than that, TNT 245, but like real life things, no, I don't add to her life in any way.
I have to tell you that my partner, Andrea, is like, I look at her sometimes, like I'll like, I don't know what I wear or what I walk around doing half the time. And I'm like, hey, are you sure you want to be with me? Cause this is it. This is not getting better. Mm-hmm. This is, okay, first of
all. My general approach is like, hey, you can't die because I don't know where anything in this house is. I'm not worried she's going to leave. I'm worried she's like going to pass away. And then I'll be like, where do we keep the garbage bags? So.
Well, and you talk a lot about that in the book, is this whole idea of like, what are you supposed to do with a house? And I have to tell you, I thought about that a lot today because, you know, I'm actually in Toronto right now. It's where I've been isolating the last few months because it's where my partner Andrea lives. And she doesn't own her home, but we had like a water leakage in the plumbing issue in the kitchen sink. And I was just like, well, put a towel on it. You know, and in your book, it's like, honestly, all of your questions, I was like, I don't know how to do that.
Yeah, me neither. The thing is, like, I still kind of don't. And we lived here for a few years, and it's like a busted, like, messed up old farmhouse, right? So a lot of things go wrong, and we have fixed them, I think. We have hired people to fix them, but I still am like, what did they say they did? Like, I don't remember. So when things like inevitably break in like 5 years, we'll call the same people out and be like, I don't remember what we got last time, but could you do that?
Do it again.
Again? Yeah.
Have you like bought the you know, the lesbian Home Depot tool belt? Like, and what is, have you looked at one? Here's what I think. Maybe.
So, there is a dream. I have a dream that like, maybe I could be useful, but I don't, at this point I would have to learn what everything is before I even could begin to fix it. It's too late. I'm not doing, I can like point to the toilet and the dishwasher, but like, I don't know what the little turny thing in the dishwasher I don't know what that's called. I don't know what it's connected to. It's too late for me. So there's like a dream. Every time I get a bill, because everything we do is an emergency and we have to like call the expensive people because we don't, you know how everybody's like, my friend Johnny, he fixes lawnmowers. He could do it.
I got a guy.
We have no guy or girl or anyone. So we call like when you put plumber into Google, like whoever bought the biggest ad, that's who we call. And like, every time you pay the bill, it's like, oh man, if I learned how to twist a wrench, maybe I could do this myself and save $7 million. But then I look at the wrench and I'm like, no.
No. And we'll I have to tell you, a friend of mine who does do that, she just messaged on this WhatsApp group of ours. She literally yesterday said, oh, I got electrocuted. And I'm like, that's why you don't do it yourself.
Correct. I can't, I'm guided by shame through life. Like you know how some people are like principled and like, they're led by what's like right. I am guided by shame, which keeps me out of a lot of bad things, I think. And like, I would hate to go to the hospital and be like, yeah, I electrocuted myself trying to fix, the kitchen light. I cannot imagine doing that. Or like, heaven forbid I die and then Kirsten has to like tweet for me that I electrocuted myself and you're getting no more books. So yeah, I just leave it alone.
I think that's really fair and smart. Also, I have to tell you that I love in the book where you talk about the fact that now that you are married, while you might not be an expert on, on fixing the house, you are an expert on marriage.
I mean, isn't that all it takes, is just to get married and then you feel comfortable dispensing marital advice? I mean, that's how everyone I've ever met who's gotten married has done it.
It's true. It's like those straight white guys are just like, here's how it goes. Let me tell you something.
Isn't it funny? It's like the assholes you went to high school with, like they got married 10 years ago and they're like, let me tell you. And it's like, bitch, I saw you fail physics or whatever. Don't tell me shit. Like, remember when you couldn't do algebra? Keep your marriage advice, you dumbass.
Well, I actually think you give really good relationship advice in the book. And it took me a long time to figure this out. And the part that I related to was when you talk about the fact that there is not one person and like, or this idea of like the perfect person for you. And I love the way you said it, because it's like, first you have to recognize there being one right perfect person is a fallacy sold to you by romantic comedies.
Yeah.
Dismantle the lie that finding said person is achievable. And I'm like, bitch, where was that? I needed that years ago. Like, I just figured that out. I was looking for the Bollywood romance, you know?
I mean, I understand, like, I love the lie, right? Like, I love the happy ending, and I love the, like, clandestine getting together of it all. But when that doesn't happen for you ever, you know, like, I was 36, 37 when we got married, and it's like, once you're like waiting 37 years, I guess when I was a baby, I didn't really care about romance. But so let's say from middle school on, where you're waiting for someone to fall in love with you, and it doesn't until much, much later, it's very easy to sort of pick apart the delusion that you're supposed to have a perfect person. And then you get to the point where it's like, where you're every, year by year, it's like your standards get sort of low, or not standards, but your expectations for what romance is get more and more realistic, where it's just like, okay, won't steal from me, doesn't wear mesh shirts in public.
Changes underwear regularly.
Yeah. Yes.
I think that's important. Actually, I was thinking that I would pay to watch you have a show like Judge Mathis, where you wore a robe, had a gavel, and
this could be my robe. It's close enough.
This is what I'm saying. I think I can find an old gavel from like an old law award that I got back in the day of lawyering.
Keep talking.
Okay. And people came up to you and they had to stand at their separate little benches, like on Judge Mathis, and they asked you for relationship advice. We could do it online. We could do it social distance. They could be in their little home, in their little box. You'd be in another one. And you could just bang the gavel at them, make decisions, and yell at them and tell them this truth.
Sold. And because you're a lawyer, you could work out all the contracts so that I don't get sued for what is sure to be terrible advice.
Oh, I mean, all of those shows, whether it's good or bad advice, they're all like ironclad contracts are being signed for sure. It's like, I'm sure like all of those people who come on the shows are basically like, you know, have to sign away their life and like a child of, or like give DNA. Yeah, for sure.
Organ. I probably will need a new liver eventually. So they can give me an organ, make sure they can't sue me, and I will give them advice. The thing is, we could take this to a network, right?
I honestly, I mean, I don't know, Quibi, they're, well, I don't know what they're doing. We could make an Instagram show. We could sell this to Freeform.
Great, yes. I'm sure if my agent is watching, he's like, stop giving away this IP.
Oh, I'm sure if my agent is watching, he's like, Fazia, great. Get these ideas out of your system. You have too many.
Come back to me with the real ideas. Like, get these jokes off and then get serious and come back to me.
Okay, here's the other thing I have to tell you. Okay, because as I sent, those of you watching may not know, but I sent Sam a photo of me reading her book.
I almost posted that, and then I thought, like, you would, I was like, no, that's too personal.
I mean, I thought about, I actually wondered if you asked me if I would say yes, and I was like, you know what? What, we're in a pandemic, Black people are being killed for no reason still, doesn't matter. Is a lot going, and I'm like, what does it matter if a post picture of me with my pandemic arm hair and you're passed out with a bottle of vodka and your book on my crotch, like, that's fine. I encourage
it. Okay, I made, okay, then, I mean, you heard it here, everyone.
Oh, boy.
No, I saw it and I was like, this is how my book should be enjoyed. On your back, passed out.
Yeah.
Vodka bottle nearby, yes, after having read, you know, three words
and
deciding it's enough. You're like, oh, do we get it? And then you throw the book down and go to sleep.
Exactly. It was great. I've had like a great nap. I felt so fulfilled.
And I put that for you. Listen, you, that's that, just another layer of marketing that I can use. Like, pandemic insomnia.
Yeah.
Read this book.
Wow, no, thank you.
Yeah. Wow, no, thank you, insomnia.
No, but I want to tell you, I read this part and I went to my partner the next day and I said, babe, I can't wait to ask Sam about this part of the book. And she's like, what part? And I said, well, it's the part where she talks about showering and how she doesn't wash her legs. And I said, babe, I don't wash my legs either. And she's like, you don't?
Okay. First of all, I sort of threw that in as like a...
Are you about to throw me under the bus?
No. I put it in as a nod to the war that raged online about leg washing. And here's the thing, sometimes, well, I don't go anywhere. So my life is like generally sort of pandemic-ish. It's shelter at home-ish. I don't go a lot of places, you know, before this. So it's like when you're inside all day and your clothes are clean and you bathe every day, you don't have to do a deep exfoliating scrub to the bottom part of your calves. You don't have to, or at least I don't have to. They like get soapy and wet. I always scrub everything else. I mean, maybe not always my like arms, but again, I'm always fully clothed. I don't wear short pants or really short sleeves. I'm covered every day and I don't go anywhere. I don't know that I need to bleach myself and scrub down to the wood every
single day. Yes. And I want to say that I feel a lot of freedom being able to talk about this for the first time.
That's what I wanted to give to people.
Like being your authentic self, right? I mean, right now I'm wearing like a sports bra, Canada socks, and like, so I'm ready to go to the gym underneath this like cute shirt. But I don't, the arms and the legs, like, what are they really doing wrong that we need to hurt them?
Nothing. Also, if your skin is dry, I mean, and I do lotion every day, but sometimes you don't need the harsh soap on them.
Exactly, like the hair, same.
Oh, you filthy bitch. But I'm sorry, I don't always, I mean, a lot of times, but not always.
I probably wash my arms and legs less than you, I think. And I'm okay with that. Also, I want to say that a lot of the same people who are judgy about the arms and the legs, they wipe their butts with toilet paper and don't use water ever. And as a Muslim growing up, like we're just like, what are you doing? It's like going to this, you're basically at the beach with sand on your butt the whole day. Yes. So there's some things to talk about. So I have to ask you, you in lockdown, in this mainstream lockdown, let's call it that. Okay. Is there something that you have purchased that you were like, it's like your best purchase of the last like 2.5 months?
Oh man, well, okay, not to be too on the nose or on the chest or whatever, but this is a universal standard pajama top. It's cool. Got like it's sort of like a short robe, like a shirt length robe. It doesn't have any closures. You just kind of wrap it around yourself and it comes with a belt and you tie the belt on and it's got like a drapey sleeve situation. And it's made like, so a lot of times, this is going to be a tangent that nobody gives a shit about, but a lot of times lounge clothes are too flimsy. Like, I don't want to feel like I'm wearing a piece of Kleenex. And so this is loungy and like cool and soft and relaxed, but it has like enough weight to it that it feels like an actual shirt. So this is maybe the best, and I'm not being paid or anything. I bought it with my own bad credit. And it was worth it. It's worth it. It's so, so, so good.
Honestly, I feel like the rest of the world is catching up to folks who are like yourself, who are just like, yeah, I understand what is comfortable. Like, why would I wear things that are un-fucking comfortable? Like, why would I do that to my body and myself? Like, so much is already uncomfortable in the world. And it's like, you're like, this feels good. It's got a belt. I can cinch it how and wherever I want versus being governed by the patriarchy controlling.
Does the patriarchy run the zipper and button industry? Yeah. Well,
come on, Sam. Yeah.
I mean, the thought of a buttoned pair of pants like truly makes me want to cry.
I mean, I'm wearing like just these soft workout pants that sometimes I sleep in, and then I wake up and work out and spend the day in and then go back to sleep in. And you know, it's just, it's a great, why haven't...
I'm wearing Christmas pajama bottoms. Like they have like printed, they have like little string lights printed on them. Oh my God. That's the thing. If things ever really get back to normal, I know they won't. People are gonna have a hard time adjusting to like not wearing exercise pants and Canada socks. I feel like, hopefully there will be enough of us who cling to the comfortable way of life that we can make it more mainstream. Also, I just want to say that I have worn pajamas or pajama adjacent clothing to so many things and no one has been the wiser. Like if you've met me, you have seen me in something that other people sleep in, but I wear clothes.
Well, and also like I feel like calling something, like identifying something as like, this is what you must wear to sleep and this is what you must wear, you know, out to meet people in the world. It's the same thing as saying this is, you can only eat eggs for breakfast. And it's like, I'm sorry, have you ever been to Korea? Like Korean culture is about eggs are for everything. It's a protein. I feel like the same standard applies to pajamas. That's just a white man's term.
Yeah.
You know?
It's right. There's some like conspiracy, I'm sure, to get us to buy multiple sets of clothing. The thing is, I don't want to exclude anyone who loves like wearing a suit or whatever, if that's
fair.
Fair. Cool. But I want the rest of us, those of us who are sensible and like to, you know, relax, I want it to be more acceptable for us to like go to a restaurant and have our pants be drawstring.
I'm supportive of this extremely. I feel like people watching probably also want to know things other than our level of comfort with clothing, although I feel like this is like probably like a number one, number two kind of topic.
But I mean, everybody's relaxing now. I'm sure they just want to get more cozy.
Relaxed. Yeah. I know. I have to tell you, by the way, my best purchase so far of the quarantine has been, I bought like 8 pounds of lentils, a headlamp, and a mini trampoline. Like,
Fazia.
Just trying to show up.
What is the headlamp for?
What if it got worse? What if the electricity was going to go out?
See, that's a difference between us because I refuse to make any panic like apocalyptic purchases. Like if it gets worse, like I am a person who will just let the zombies eat me first. Like you get a head start, I'm going to fall down in front of them and let them feast on me while you get away. I do not want to live through the bad, you know, like the idea of like surviving the plague, not me.
No, you're right. Yeah.
Let it take me first.
You talk about that a little bit in the book, and I'm like, yeah, you know what? You're right. But the headlamp, I feel like, is also useful just if like a breaker goes out. Or,
do you know what a breaker is?
I mean, Point Break.
Do you know how to fix a breaker?
I know how to flip one. You just go like that.
And you need a headlamp. Well, I guess you could, you don't have a light on your phone.
What if the phone dies? Look, there were a few things. I also ordered a fish turner. That's an essential item. Mm.
No, now that I understand. That I get. The lamp is too. It's just the headlamp. I'm like, girl.
Girl, I know. It's my issue. Listen, tell me about this. I gotta say, I obviously you've worked for TV, you've written for TV, of all the amazing things you've done. You wrote on Shrill. You wrote the like epic pool party episode of Shrill that basically like changed people's lives. And no, truly, and I say this also as like someone, you know, I'm queer and Muslim and brown and, mm-hmm. you know, a woman and all these things. And often, like, often always feel like an outsider. And even though I couldn't relate, that was not my exact experience watching that episode. Mm-hmm. I was crying the whole time because it was so specific. I think it's such a brilliant example. Your writing was such a brilliant example of when you lean into authenticity and specificity, it is so fucking relatable, because it was so relatable to me, being like, oh my gosh, I would love to walk into a party where all of these people are experiencing the same kind of, or my shame, my insecurities are all like, I can put them on this table over here for a minute and just be. Can you talk a little bit about like what that was like and kind of like the reactions to that? You know, just like what that was like how you were putting that episode together.
Yeah, so we knew we had 6 episodes, and we knew that over the arc of the season, we wanted Annie, the main character, to have an event that was like, that started to shift. Cause you know, it's a years long process accepting yourself. I mean, I'm not even there yet. Who is, right?
Yeah,
but we wanted to start to like turn the tide on like how she saw herself and how she felt about her body. And so we were coming up with ideas of like how, because it's also, you want to like show it to an audience, but without it being like cheesy or hokey. You don't want her to sit up in bed and go, all bodies are good bodies. You know, you don't want to do that. Right. So it was just like, how can we in a super visual way kind of see a quick change in her? And Lindy and I were both talking about kind of all these like fat girl specific spaces that we had been in and heard about, the clothing swaps, the dance parties, that kind of thing, parties. And we thought that like, I mean, any of those would have been like, would have served the purpose and been amazing. But it felt like a pool party is the most visceral. And so many people, even fat people, are like, they see someone like in a swimsuit. I know sometimes my inclination is to like worry that they like, oh, are they okay? Is someone like teasing them or oinking at them or whatever it is that people do? Like my knee-jerk reaction is to be very protective. And we thought like, wouldn't it be incredible if they let us get away with it? Cause that was always like part of it too. Yeah. If we can get away with this, it would be incredible to just have a bunch of fat women and non-binary people of all ages. Cause that was another thing, enjoying themselves and watching a person who's not used to that experience that. And I remember like the old days of Tumblr, just kind of scrolling through all these pictures of like fat women in lingerie and being like, they're not afraid. She's not afraid. She's not afraid. And how like big of an impact that had on me. And so I thought we really needed to see it too, not just hear about a party or whatever, but really like see it and experience it. So we all sort of pitched every episode together. And then I was assigned that one to write, which I, at the time, I, you know, you don't know that a thing you're making is going to be impactful. I'm not a fucking asshole. I'm not going to be like, they gave me the one that's really going to make a mark on America. You know what I mean? I was like, oh my God, I'm going to write this. And then I'm going to get 4,000 emails calling me a fat bitch. So I wrote it and we, you know, I outlined it and then I wrote the script and turned it in, and the room was super short. So like the week after we finished in the room, they went to Portland to start shooting. And so I flew out to Portland to watch the episode. And like, it was my first experience in a room. So I didn't know like what would change and what would be different. And I still don't know, and probably will never know, like how they figure out what they can afford or what they're gonna spend on your episode and all that stuff.
Yeah.
And so in the script, I was like, you know, I want it to look like Candyland and I want it to just be bright and happy and all that stuff. And then, you know, you hand it off and it goes through the hands of a million other people, the people who put the sets together and the costumes and the casting. And so I got to Portland and the first 2 days we shot the scenes in the house. And one of them is where Adi gives that speech that I wrote about. She gives this like really emotional speech. I don't want to give it away for anyone who hasn't seen it. And like, that was like incredible to see. And like, we're all in Video Village, like crying, watching it. And then on the third day we went to this, country club where they turned it into the pool party, and Lindy and I walked back to see the pool and I like gasped. It was so beautiful. And I was like, oh man, they're really gonna make this thing the way I envisioned it. Cause you never know, right? And so then we went into the ballroom to see all of the extras. And that was my last bit of nervousness. I was like, cause you know, some people are like a medium is fat, right? So I'm like, are we gonna walk in and see like a bunch of size 6 women, you know, who have like one little tiny pooch or whatever. And we walked in and we saw this like wide range of women, and women in wheelchairs and non-binary people, and they really got it right. And there was like full costuming, and it wasn't just like, okay, fatty, bring a bathing suit. They had full costumes and hair and makeup, and they really were paying attention. And I was like, oh, this is amazing. And then, you know, they shot it, I went home, and then that's it, right? Like you go back to your life. And then the show came out, and I got to see the episode and I was like, oh, that looks really good. I mostly was concerned because we were at the party and I was like, I look like a psychopath. I don't know if anyone has found me, but I look kind of insane. So I was mostly worried about that. I'm like, did anyone see me hiding in the corner? But then like the feedback starts, you know, you start reading the reviews and the feedback comes in. And that was when it was like, okay, we made an incredible thing, you know? And it's like, it is a gift. I mean, it's clear that they spent so much money and so much time and effort to really make it beautiful. And that is not a thing I felt entitled to or expected at all. You just kind of do your best and hand it off to someone else. And so seeing like the care that went into it was just really incredible. And then seeing how that resonated with people and like what critics say, whatever. But I got like tons of DMs and comments and people reaching out and people saying what it meant to them. And that's when I was like, okay, I did a good thing. And it resonated with the people we made it for, which is true.
I mean,
the most.
Girl, I'm like still like, it makes me emotional. Like, I'm just like, oh my God, it's so beautiful. I mean, it truly is. And it's like those moments, and it is beautiful. And it's like, you crave seeing yourself. You're just like, how am I normal as a human in this husk of this meat husk thing on my body? Like, how am I a human if I don't see myself anywhere else except in the mirror? Or and television is that powerful.
Normal, right?
Yes.
What kind of life am I supposed to have if I never see that reflected? Especially people who maybe don't live in big cities or don't live in places with a wide variety of people. It's important to know that your experience is not singular. Like, yes, you are a unique person
who's
only living your one life, but it helps to know that other people out there are feeling the same thing you feel and struggling with the things that you struggle with. I feel like it helps even just to see, I mean, not only to have something to aspire to, but just to see someone else's experience. Maybe you'd never be the kind of person to go to a pool party. I think it's like freeing just to know that that exists and just to know that other people are having those experiences, even if you can't or it doesn't apply to you.
Oh my God. Yeah. I mean, I was raised with such a, you know, shame narrative that like, mm-hmm. I wore a bikini for the first time. I don't know. I think I was 34 or something like that. Mm-hmm. I just didn't understand. I was like, how do you have a gap in you show that part, like, and the thighs, like I have all these, and honestly, you really inspire me to like be more open and honest about like the things that I want to talk about, you know, and I have to tell you, Sam, like reading your book this time, I think where I'm at, I was just like, yeah, like your power, you are so open and so real and free, like whether it's about your body, your struggles, your truth, your comedy, your trauma, your experience in Hollywood, like writing about like, this is what it was like pitching a show. This is what it was like writing in a writer. I have never seen anyone else do that. And I think especially after working in Hollywood for a couple of years now, I'm like, oh, nobody does this.
Yeah.
Nobody wants transparency. And you are so just like, this is what it is. It's not glamorous. It just is.
I always want to dispel any idea that anything I have or am doing is fancier or unattainable than anything anyone else is doing. So if I can be like, hey, this is what it's like. I wore an Old Navy sweatshirt to HBO and got my period on the couch. You too could do that. Like, I'm just a regular asshole. Like, you, if I can do it, you could do it for sure. Like, that is always the goal, to be like, oh, a horrible thing happened to you. Well, to me too. And now we can relate about it.
I love it. Okay. I gotta say, I have so many other things I want to ask you about, but also there's folks who have sent in questions that want to ask you questions as well. This is the first one. Tori Amos, Fiona Apple, Dave Matthews, Mary Fuck Kill.
Oh my God. Okay.
All right.
Okay.
I know.
I'm going to drink. Mary, this is going to be terrible. Mary, Dave Matthews. Do I need to give the reasons? I feel like I have to. Dave is so pleasant. His singing voice is so beautiful. He's very calm. You can't, I love Tori and Fiona, but that would be like a lifetime of volatility.
I mean, you heard the new album.
Like the sweet stoner. Okay. Mary, Dave.
Oh boy.
Oh, fuck Tori.
Because I have an
experience. So then by default, I have to kill Fiona, but I love her. But
I don't even know what to do.
I know.
By default.
I can feel people unfollowing me on all platforms.
Yeah, I mean, or following you. You know what I mean? Like it's all balances each other out. All right. Okay.
I'm sorry, everyone. I just love Dave and he's so nice.
I mean, crash into me, you know, like I know that's the popular song, but I mean, I definitely walked on a sticky fraternity floor listening to that. Okay, here's a question.
Okay.
What is your opinion of Greg Mathis's fashionable glasses evolution?
His current frames, the heavy round ones that he is wearing lately, if you were up on, he used to wear little tiny metal ones, which is not really my vibe, but he has followed the Samantha Irby trajectory and he is now wearing very heavy black plastic round frames and they are incredible. 10 out of 10. Those are amazing.
See, I'm trying to keep up.
You have good taste. The Greg's glasses game right now is chef's kiss. Great.
Okay. Okay.
These are how about good questions?
These are solid. I mean, I'm very, very impressed. I also wonder, like, what is it? I mean, how many, like, mini essays, how many great Judge Mathis, you know, you've done like 100 at this point? Like, is that
up to 104?
104. Now, is this, what is the drive? Is it that it's so damn good? Or is it like, I'm going to just get to a tipping point?
Well, so it's
and get your own show and get your own show.
It started as a bit, right? Like I have watched Judge Mathis for years and I've probably been to the set like 7 times and like watched tapings because it's so great. I mean, truly like 20 years ago, sitting in the audience. And I just like tweeted it as a joke and people were like, yeah, you should do it. So then I was like, okay, I'll do it. And then if people like sign up for this newsletter, I guess I'll keep doing it. And like 7,300 people subscribe to that stupid newsletter. Only like a very small sliver of them pay for it, which is fine. But 7,300 people every day almost get an email from me. And I'm like, and now I don't know how to stop. Eventually the show will get canceled and then I'll have to either pivot to something else or like bury it in the yard. But
well, I want you to know I did tag. I did tag Judge Mathis and Forrest Whitaker in my posts about today's talk, you know, because you are, there's going to be a meeting of the minds.
Okay. What if, let me pitch this.
Okay. I'm ready.
Hollywood is always like, let me pitch you a thing.
We're pitching.
Judge show based on Judge Mathis starring Forrest Whitaker. Will you write that pilot with me?
Yes. And set in Chicago.
Yeah.
Yeah, of course. Oh my God. I have like a fantastic judge I know that we can talk to. It's my law school town. All right. Here we are.
That's my next project. Cheers.
This is how deals are made. Okay.
You guys, in 10 years when CBS, NBC...
Untitled CBS, Forrest Whitaker lawyer judge show is a hit.
You will Chicago remember ideas. That you were here for the inception.
Yeah. Okay, here's another question. Okay. This one's really important. What do you miss most about Evanston? Bill's Burgers...
Oh,
fish keg, the hippie yoga ladies.
Who sent that? Somebody who knows my heart. Fish keg number one, Bill's drive-in number two, yoga ladies number three.
Okay.
That is a real Evanston person because those are not places that like people who don't live in Evanston go. Bill's, that has to be someone who knows me. Text me if you know me and you sent that question. It's gotta be like my sister.
That's real specific. I was like, this is good.
Yeah.
The fish keg, I don't think I've ever, I mean, I haven't been to a lot of places in Evanston, I'll be honest.
It's okay.
I know.
It's just north of the city. It's not far. Let's meet when we're all vaccinated. Meet there together. Okay. The Fish Keg is on Howard Street, like just west of Chicago Avenue. Just west of Ridge. And there are no seats. You order fried fish, they put it in, you order it by the like pound, half pound, quarter pound. They put it in a bag and you like eat it while weeping in your car. And it is the best.
Can I tell you something? A, I'm down to do that in a heartbeat. B, I have done that more times in LA than any time in my life. Like get a bag of food and then just eat it in your car on the side. That's my favorite thing.
Yeah,
it's incredible. That's Hollywood.
Yeah. We're doing that in Evanston when we come to film.
With the vaccine, once we're, judge, yeah, when we're,
yeah.
Yeah. I also have to say, the person who asked the question is Angie? Ange?
I don't know. I know.
Okay, they've read your work. Okay, I have a question, question. List, can you tell everyone about what you've been, well, I know people want to know, like, when's the next book? Also, I want to know what you've been working on, because I know you've been working on a TV show, writing for a TV show that took you from pre-pandemic to whatever this is now. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Of course. So as for the next book, I don't know. We haven't pitched it yet.
People are thirsty out there, Sam. I just talked
to my agent. Well, here's the thing. I have to like do some more stuff so that I can write about it.
We gotta go to the Fish Keg.
Yes, we have to go to the Fish Keg so I can write about it. Okay, that's gonna be an essay. We're gonna do something and I'll write about it.
We have to
immortalize us forever.
Yeah.
So I just talked to my agent and he's like, yeah, it's about time to pitch another thing. So I'm going to write a proposal. Here's the thing. Luckily for me, I'm at the stage where, and because of what I do, I can just be like, okay, more of the same, give me some money. And so that's what I'm going to do. I'm not even going to write a full proposal. It's just going to be on the back of a napkin. I'm going to be like, you know what it is.
So Don Draper of you. So Don Draper.
Poop and buds, give me $1 million. So we'll see how that strategy works. I was just in Chicago. There's a show on Showtime called Work in Progress.
Yes.
Abby Mack, who is like a genius, a comic genius. An improv genius. It's incredible. It's like super, super queer and super funny. And it's produced by Lily Wachowski. I worked on the second season. We wrote the second season in Chicago and then pandemic hit and they were like, go home. So then we all had to flee back to our homes. Like I drove to Michigan and there were like state troopers just like lined up on the highway.
Michigan.
Making sure everybody was like not bringing the virus them or whatever. So yeah, I just worked on that and it was supposed to shoot this summer, but everything is shut down. So it'll shoot eventually. And then you can watch it, but you can watch season one on Showtime. It's incredible. And then imagine my jokes in the season while you're watching it.
I have to tell you, I am so excited. And honestly, I mean, I am inspired by you to just be my honest truth. I definitely met with them to like write for the show. And when I heard you got a one of the jobs there, I was like, yeah, like you should be the person writing with that team and with Abby and with Lily. Like it's just a no-brainer. So I'm super excited.
I love Abby. We weren't there. We could have had so much fun.
Well, we are going to find that thing. We've talked about this for a long time and we'll find it. And I'm so grateful to get this time to chat with you. I guess we gotta go. I'm getting the nudge and the wink.
Oh, they're giving us the light. Okay.
The elbow, like hand on the elbow thing.
The hook is coming.
Oh boy, it's like a big cane. I'm just very scared. It's very awkward. The Chicago Ideas game.
And I'm so glad we got this time. And I'm so glad Chicago Ideas let us, you know, blab at each other for an hour.
Too. It's awesome. Thank you so much. And honestly, y'all, you've got to buy this book. It's absolutely incredible. It's, you know, you can get it. I know Kevin's going to talk about this soon. Look how beautiful it is. I have to tell you, I read it on the streets of Toronto and I posted it on my Instagram, but it's such a great book. And you're just such a great person to think about. Like when you're like, how do I write? It's like, write honestly, truthfully, and like celebrate your experiences, whatever they are. That's what's going to connect to people.
That's so sweet. You are the best.
Thanks, Sam. It was so great chatting with you. All right, Kevin, I guess we're done here, but
okay, bye
to you. Bye.
Thanks, guys. All right, Fozzie, Sam, thanks so much for joining us. I'm glad to know that I don't have to feel bad about wearing pants that don't have buttons. That was a good insight for me. Everyone who's watching, make sure you pick up a copy of Sam's book. You can go online and get it from unabridged bookstores here in Chicago, or if you're not in Chicago, your favorite local bookseller has it. You also want to check out Fozzie's groundbreaking new project, Hidden Canyons, which is an LGBTQ soap series told in 1 minute long episodes. I just watched all of them today. They're fantastic, and there'll be new episodes coming out throughout the summer. Tonight's event was just one of many on our calendar. So if you want to find out more about events like this and other great virtual programming, subscribe to our newsletter or check us out on chicagoideas.com. All right, everybody, have a great night. Thanks for joining us.